looking into the benefits and the impact that the London Olympics has had. We have an exceptionally credible panel to talk about their experiences, their views. It will be a healthy debate, looking into the pros and cons, but we're all looking forward to what will be expressed later. I just want to just give you a bit of an insight into why sport and tourism is really becoming a forefront within the WTM. As we know, the tourism sector continuously grows. Even under the economic impacts everybody's facing now, we're now finding that tourism continues to drive, with over 1 billion international footfall arrivals due for this year, which is looking into the first 4 months of this year with a 5% growth year on year. We position that in the terms of where sport and tourism fits into the tourism sector. Importantly, it's one of the sectors that is adding to this contribution of growth. Importantly, in terms of what sport is adding to the tourism sector, it works at about 14% of the GDP of the travel sector is from sport and tourism. When you break that down into certain territories, if we take Australia, for example, about 55% of the GDP of tourism is driven through sport activities and sports to tourism in Australia. You kind of question why that is, and I go out and I talk in the market about sport and tourism. It's one of my kind of flagship zones that I have to talk about from Southeast Asia, which is a great place to be and talk about sports tourism. Why? It's because sport and tourism have similar values. They're very cross-connected, they're universal, they're involving, they're community-based, they're adventurous, and they're exciting. And what we find, though, is obviously with the passion of sport and with the passion of travel, the two coming together is an exceptionally strong formula for tourism destinations to massively capitalize upon. We find that people are traveling now in the world of sport for the aspect of participation, for the aspect of spectatorship, nostalgia. Participation in areas such as golf, which is one of the most obvious, but still one of the largest growing. You're also finding in the terms of golf, as we see in the last point here, tapping into that passion of somebody's passion of travel and sport can be highly profitable as well. We've found from the research that we carry out is a golfer, for example, is four times more valuable to a tourism destination than the average tourist that goes there. Nostalgia-wise, when you go to these stadiums, maybe it's the Olympic Stadium or whether it's FC Barcelona, people go to these cities and experience the sporting activities. People are traveling not just for their beach and recreation, but building sporting activities into their rationale for going and traveling these days. From your sports aspect, we obviously invest a lot into the research to understand the power and growth of sports tourism. There's some stats here that we've found recently that 34% are checking sporting events in a city and area that they're actually visiting. So people are researching and adding sport into their agenda of traveling. 32% spend on their holidays as a means of attending a sporting event, so they focus their holidays around sporting events. We would have experienced that in London here. And 22% have already booked their holidays for the next 12 months focused around a sports holiday. So we have a very active and profitable tourism sector. In terms of sporting events, this is obviously the most obvious one and the one that we've all been faced with this year. Why do tourism boards continuously invest in these sporting events? You have the obvious media and promotion aspects from awareness, the elevation, the brand shift, the perception changes as well. I go to India and you see what they've done with F1, bringing that event there is an obvious way of shifting the perception of a destination from one into a higher esteem category. In terms of the short-term and long-term impact that sporting events have, it's fairly obvious that if the event is done well, the footfall is successful, the economic impact is there. Euro 2004 in Portugal, with over 500,000 individuals went to Portugal in that five-week period, contributing $320 million within that five-week period. So a significant gain was benefited from hosting Euro 2004. So really, just to summarize that, I just want to obviously take the point forward that from Eurosport's point of view, we focus in this area. We work with tourism boards, we work with federations to not just to host these events, but to obviously activate these events for the benefits of the tourism board to drive awareness and to ultimately drive footfall as well. We can reach different targets by activating on their passions. The awareness is gained and the long-term economic and social benefits can obviously be hugely advantageous. And the platforms that we offer can obviously contribute to tourism boards and success. Before handing on to Ken, I just want to show you a quick video that will give you an overview on the Eurosport platform, but also kind of recapture some of the images that we've all experienced in 2012. Thank you very much.
Eurosport is a worldwide reference in communication and innovation. Benefit from this quantitative environment reinforced by our experts.
The leader of the new generation.
Check this out.
It started well. We won the title in Valencia.
The powerful Eurosport platform will help you generate visibility for your communication across Europe. Join us on Eurosport in 2013.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Ken Robinson. I'm chair for your seminar this afternoon. I'd like to say how grateful I was to Eurosport last year, because in the bizarre world of Olympic branding, we could only have done our seminars last year on the Olympics because Eurosport were an Olympics broadcaster. Otherwise, that might have been tricky. For any of you interested in the morass of Olympics branding and how we're planning to change it, can I invite you to attend a seminar on Wednesday on the issues of branding when we think we've got something interesting to tell you. Today's session is the second of two. We had one last year looking forward to the Olympics, and this is one talking about what actually happened. And it is, incidentally, for those of you that don't come from the UK, the first time we've done this. So since the Olympics, there really hasn't been a debrief. This is the first debrief. We have a stellar team of speakers for you who will come up now one after the other to join us, and I would like to ask you to welcome them as they do. First is Sandy Dorr, Chief Executive of Visit Britain, who are of course responsible for all the marketing of Britain overseas. Thank you, Sandy. Second, and if you don't know him, David Edwards, who is the Head of Research and Forecasting at Visit Britain. And David is the hidden genius of understanding tourism to and within the UK. He's a brilliant chap and we're jolly pleased we've got him. In charge of domestic tourism in Britain, sorry to go back one, is James Beresford, Chief Executive of Visit England. James, welcome. And from London and Partners, which incorporates Visit London, we have Gordon Innes, who's theirs Chief Executive. Gordon. Then somebody who has written extensively on the Olympic Games, not always to the enjoyment of officialdom, Tom Jenkins, Chief Executive of the European Tour Operators Association. His bottle is probably for self-defense purposes, not necessarily for drinking. And lastly, from the UK inbound, Mary Rance, who is the Chief Executive. Please welcome Mary Rance. Well, I have to tell you before we get going that we had the most fantastic year. Any of you who are not from Britain, it was mind-blowingly good. Everything worked well. Nothing went wrong. A few things went wrong, but they were so tiny that nobody noticed. And even people in the tourism industry enjoyed it thoroughly. However, things in the tourism industry weren't as easy as all that. Here's a few things that we did before the Games in order to try and make things work well. The first was that we analysed the tourism effects of previous Olympic Games. This may sound obvious. It isn't obvious because before this Games it was quite difficult to get hold of hard facts. The OCOGs disband immediately after each Games, and there's good records of ticket buyers, but not of tourists. The second thing we did was to recognise the difference between Olympics-related visitors that come for the Games and for any event to do with the Games, and those that may come subsequently as Olympics-motivated visits. The third thing we did was to try to manage hyped expectations. Our government enthusiastically told us that we would welcome 1 million extra inbound visitors for the Olympics. Well, we said we didn't think it would be 1 million and they wouldn't be extra. And getting the message across that people that come to the Olympics take the place of normal leisure or business visitors is a tough task. The next thing we did was, and I think we're probably the first nation to have done this, we recognised and hoped to reduce the displacement and deterrent effects of the Olympics on regular tourism. It's a fact, it can't be avoided, and some things were done. We also had to work within reducing budgets, because this occurred, this run-up to the Olympics, in the period after the economic debacle and when budgets for our agencies were reducing. We also had to work within these quite extraordinary Olympics branding and marketing rules, which means, for example, that Visit Britain couldn't call itself the host nation, Visit London couldn't say it was the host city of the Olympic Games, and a hotel couldn't talk to a potential customer and say would they like to visit them for the Games. All these are things which are prohibited by Olympics branding rules, which we're trying to change for the benefit of people in the future. And lastly, we tried to harness the enthusiasm for the Olympics that there was to support tourism initiatives. Throughout our public sector, some things were eased up by the spectacle of the advancing Olympics, and we tried to harness that. So there's the sort of way we approached it. And now, to give you the detailed story, I'm delighted to welcome the first of our speakers, who is Sandy Dorr, CEO of Visit Britain. Sandy.
Thank you. All right, thank you. Thank you, Ken. Good afternoon, everybody. Well, Ken set the scene quite nicely about how we saw the Olympics and what some of the challenges were. At Visit Britain, we took really as our inspiration this quote from Michael Payne, who's the very well-known former marketing director of the IOC. He's the guy who set up the rights-holding broadcasters program at the Olympics and their top sponsor program and so on. He did a seminar with Visit Britain in the lead up to the Games. But anyway, this is what he said, that Britain would be on the front page of every single newspaper in every single country in the world, but not only the front page, the back pages, and not only newspapers, of course, broadcast, digital, and so on. And you know this, you actually know this 7 years in advance. You are going to be center stage, so how do you make the most of the opportunity? And, you know, for us, it was very, very much about showcasing Britain. So we said this is what we set out to do. We wanted to promote a positive image of the UK. Now, London's hosting the Games. We wanted Britain also to be the hero. We wanted to reach new customers in emerging markets. We know that so many millions of people around the world are watching the Olympics. They might be more interested in the Olympics than they are in London or Britain. They might have a hazy idea of Britain. The fact that we were actually hosting the Olympics here put us on their radar, and we've got research that actually bears that out and makes it more interesting for them. We wanted to refresh Britain's appeal in core markets, so markets like the USA, France and Germany, particularly thinking about the USA. They field a huge team. The NBC is the most powerful broadcaster. They would be broadcasting many, many hours of sport. We could work with NBC to get more Britain programming out there, maybe remind Americans who've been here that there's something that they're missing out on, they need to come back, or to present Britain in a fresh light in a very key market. Also to improve our welcome, and of course a huge amount of effort went into that, as well as spontaneously around the crowds of spectators and the volunteers, which helped that particular objective hugely, and of course to ensure that there's a tourism legacy. So I've said, you know, you've got a 7-year lead-in. I mean, hosting the Olympics is no surprise, and there's plenty of time to plan and plenty of time to research and time to find out what previous hosts did and what their experience was. And I have to say that we were helped enormously by the Australians, who'd hosted the Olympics in the year 2000, and the Canadians, who hosted the Winter Games in 2010. And just dividing this up into these quadrants about what the opportunities are and some of the threats or the negatives. But really, the torch relay, the cultural festival, the fact that the games would play out against these fantastic backdrops, because we knew that the sport was going to be located on Horse Guards Parade and the sailing at Weymouth and so on, and swimming in the Serpentine, these fantastic images would go around the world, and how could we leverage that and more. The negatives, and Ken touched on some of that. There is this displacement issue. You are in the world spotlight, so there's also negative, potential for negative stories. And for us, because we are Visit Britain, not the London Tourism Agency, the host city, being very sort of host city-centric, how could we make this absolutely a Britain story? So we did set out to, over that period of 7 years, as I say, to do, you know, to do the research and the groundwork to make sure that we had our post-games marketing strategy ready to roll, what we plan to do during the games and so on. Very quickly, I mean, this is just condensing clearly like 7 years of work into one slide, but how we set about doing this. As Ken said, the context was for us a change of government in 2010. So we are a government-funded agency. Our core budget comes from government. We match fund our marketing with partners, but we are reliant on the government for funding. So we had a new government in 2010 as a result of election and a new set of ministers. And actually, thanks to Britain's budget deficit, we also had our budget cut. So in the midst of all of this, we had to do quite a significant re-engineering of Visit Britain. We had to cut down the number of international markets that we were operating in. We went from 35 to 21. But we were actually able to put more money into marketing, and we got huge interest from ministers, and we actually did get some extra money, which went into the Great Great Britain Image campaign, which many of you will have seen around the world. So a lot happened in that period, helpful and unhelpful, but having ministers who really kind of got what this was about and actually got displacement and know that it's about the legacy and that we need to build Britain's image and so on. They were very challenging, but they absolutely understood what this was all about. So we really saw the opportunities as building awareness, and through that awareness and image boost, to increase interest in travelling to Britain and therefore desire to visit, and ultimately to turn those many millions or billions of viewers into visitors. And so what I'm going to run through quickly now is what we did across PR digital, the travel industry, and then the supply side across those objectives. So we had a huge PR effort pre, during, and post the games, and a lot of this was working with rights-holding broadcasters, making sure that we helped them to get, you know, extra programs, and working with the media, taking them around the country, toolkits, you name it, working with London and partners in the London Media Centre. And we got, I mean, I think we reckon that we've achieved £3 billion worth of advertising cost equivalent editorial around the world. So that's as a result of our efforts. I'm not talking about, you know, reporting on the opening ceremony or whatever. Here are just some metrics there, the number of journalists that were accredited at the Media Centre, people that we were helping. We made 40 short films with the BBC, which were given free to media to use. Scores of media trips, and there's just an example there of the coverage we generated in China, which we reckon to be £200 million worth alone. So a huge PR and media effort. And I think if you're hosting a big sporting event or big event, if you do nothing else, you know, do have a media program, because there is a huge opportunity to leverage that media interest. So people say that the Beijing Games was the first digital games, to think the London Games were surely the first social media games, and the digital and social media opportunities were huge. So we had a big program online, as you might imagine, and Facebook and Twitter, our own website. We had a partnership with Samsung, who were a torch partner and a top sponsor. So we did, there was not enough time to talk it through, but we really focused on a strong digital presence, getting conversations going, engagement, and so on, to some of the metrics here. For example, during the opening ceremony, we were tweeting and posting images on Facebook through the opening ceremony. And so what we did were things like, there was a countryside segment, you know, if you like this, you will like, and then 10 other ideas about things to do in the country, and what, you know, we could, you know, track what people were saying as they were tweeting back. And we had 100,000 likes and comments on our Facebook page during the opening ceremony alone. So through this program, we've increased our following, we've built our following, and we've increased our engagement. So you can see there, 67% increased on engagement per post. So lots of people interacting, which is what we want. So what about the travel trade and the international travel trade? And you'll be hearing more about this from the other speakers, but we're very mindful of the displacement issue, that tour operators don't get their hotel allocations, they can't put London in their program, it's difficult to sell London, there's a big kind of stay away factor. So we worked very hard to educate the international travel trade, great reasons to continue to sell London and Britain through the year. We produced collateral, we ran seminars, we worked with the authorised ticket resellers, so people who had ticket allocations and wanted to package other parts of Britain, wanted images and itineraries and so on. And we also ran a world, what we called a World Travel Leaders Summit. During the Games, we invited 20 really influential travel buyers from around the world. We took them on tours of Britain outside London. We also brought them in to see the sport, so it was just an opportunity to sell Britain while the world's spotlight was on us. Right. That just recaps what I've said. We built a website with LOCOG. This was the official and definitive website to help the UK supply side industries and destinations to understand about the Games. So research, toolkits, events, case studies, brand protection, and so on. And finally, the day after the closing ceremony of the Paralympics, we were back in the market with a marketing campaign, just changing the opening frame of our ad to this image. Memories are great, the stadium and the fireworks. It then goes on to say, you know, culture and heritage and so on. It sells the key features of Britain, which is the great campaign that we've been running for the last year, but just adapted to kind of remind people, well, you've seen this on television, have a warm, fuzzy feeling, and this is about closing the sale, because we're in the market with partners, British Airways, EasyJet, Hilton and others, because now is the time we feel it to close the sale, having had this huge showcase. In the end, these were the objectives that the government set in relation to the Olympics 6-7 years ago, and Visit Britain's own objectives. And David, who's speaking next, is actually going to talk you through what we're measuring, what we can measure, and how things are going against that set of objectives. Thank you.
David? Go on, David, please. All of the UK statistics are going to be made publicly available, and there is an evaluation exercise being sponsored by the Department of Culture, Media and Sport. So I think Rio and future hosts have got a real opportunity here to make use of this good and accurate data. In charge of good and accurate data, David.
Thank you, Kane. Good afternoon, everybody. So I have to talk really quickly if we're going to get through this in 10 minutes, so stick with it. We don't just dabble in looking at market performance. This is something we didn't just do during the summer for the Games. We do this all of the time. And there you can see some of the tools that we use to actually monitor how inbound tourism to the UK is performing. And I'll touch on a few of those, particularly focusing on Games time during this presentation. We also look at how Visit Britain's work is delivering results. And these are some of the tools that we have at our disposal. So be that our great brand tracker, be that our evaluation of our website, social media activity. So we're in the business of monitoring how the market is performing and monitoring our performance on an ongoing basis. So how did inbound tourism perform then during the key month of August? And for many in tourism, August equals Christmas. Well, there were 3 million overseas visitors departed our shores during August this year. Yes, that was slightly down on last year by 5%, but that's still 3 million. And if we're talking about economic growth and jobs, it's how much are we earning from visits, not how many are there. And during the month of August, nearly £2.4 billion of spending by visitors from overseas, and that was a 9% increase in nominal terms on the same month of last year. All of which means, looking at the first 8 months of this year, volume is flat, value is 3% up in nominal terms, pretty much identical to what we had been forecasting for full year 2012, and indeed still are forecasting for full year 2012. Right, what do we know about the Olympics? Well, Visit Britain and the Office for National Statistics have added some particular questions to the International Passenger Survey, and those have shown that during the months of July and August, 420,000 overseas visitors departed Britain who said that they were primarily here to either watch, work at, or participate in the Olympic Games. Yes, Usain Bolt counts as an overseas visitor to Britain. He was here and he departed, therefore he counts. In addition to those people who were primarily here for the Games, the International Passenger Survey also counted those people who said they were here for business, holiday, to see friends or relatives, but also, while they were here, went to an official ticketed event. And 170,000 said that they saw a ticketed event during the Olympic or Paralympic Games. Remember, this data takes us through to the end of August, so we still have September to come. The arithmetically astute among you will have been able to add these two numbers together already and figured out that that means 590,000 visits during July and August were either primarily for the Games or involved watching a ticketed event. Lots of numbers. How are we doing in the rolling 12 months to August 2012? What we're showing here is the number of visits by broad journey purpose on the left-hand side of the slide, and over on the right, benchmarking to the best ever rolling 12 months. We can see that in terms of holiday visits, just shy of the record 12 million visits. Three rows down, business tourism, still significantly down on where it was back in 2007-2008. Same approach, but this time looking at region of the world. We've welcomed far more visitors from the EU 15 countries than we do anywhere else. Slightly down in the rolling 12 months to August, but quite significantly down, as you can see, on the record. It's the rest of Europe. These are countries such as Switzerland, Norway, Russia, that has been performing exceptionally well for us in recent months and are currently trading at record levels. We can see that North America, slightly up in the year to date. Interestingly though, North America still significantly down on the record, which was January-December of 2000. This has potential to be one of my favourite ever slides, depending on how the rest of the year pans out. The red bars are showing us the number of holiday visits to Britain each month of this year compared with the same month of last year. The blue bars show us the cumulative picture for 2012. January through to May, increasing number of holiday visits. So the blue bars getting taller and taller and taller. Then June, holiday visits quite sharply down. July, down. August, down by a little bit less. All of which means that first 8 months of this year, holiday visits are somewhat down. Now, this will be my favourite chart of all time. If once we get the September through to December data, these red bars are back above the zero line. What other evidence do we have then for summer 2012? Looking first at hotels. During games time itself, so just the nights of the Olympic Games, occupancy in hotels in London, according to STR Global, was about 5% up, but room rates were almost double what they were the same nights of 2011. Now looking at figures for July, full month, August and September, we can see that during July, overall occupancy was quite a lot down on July 2011, but rates were up. August, way before the games, we were putting together our Q&A, how many hotel rooms will be occupied during games time? We said last year, and historically it's about 82%. And hey presto, about 82% of hotel rooms were full during August. Rates were up. During September, it would appear we're back to normality with both occupancy and rates very similar to last year. What about museums? So the hotels were just about as full as they were last year. However, during July and August, the number of visitors to some of the key museums in London were significantly down. Data literally just out, however, for September, shows that all of the national museums in London were either flat or up. And some of the museums were strongly up in terms of visitor numbers during September. What about spending? We saw from one of the earlier slides that whilst volume was down, spending was up. Figures from Visa Card for the amount spent by international visitors to Britain by individual week show indeed that we were, as an economy, earning more from overseas visitors during the weeks of the Games. And fascinatingly, it does seem as though perhaps the overseas visitors here for the Games weren't going to museums and galleries, but it looks as though potentially they were shopping. And we can see also here the figures for London High Streets. Footfall up about 5% or so across the whole Games period. And yes, it was down at the beginning of the Games, in particular that first weekend, but in the West End, almost an 11% increase in footfall in the second week of the Games. We also have been monitoring sales through Visit Britain's suite of online shops right around the world. And these indeed were down in July quite significantly. In August, they were flat, September starting to rise, and October significantly up. So this is all pointing towards, yes, a dip, certainly perhaps just before the Games, but a really quite impressive recovery in September. That's more statistics than you can shake the proverbial stick at, but the Games are not about, for tourism, the three-week period. It's about how we can shift the image in the 3 years after the Games. For many years, we have been working with the Ann Holt Nations Brand Index survey to understand how Britain is seen as a nation right around the world. The 2012 fieldwork for the main study ended just ahead of the Games, so all of this data relates to pre-Games. We can see that Britain is still ranked within the top three as an overall nation brand and within the top five in terms of tourism. The weak aspects for Britain are welcome, where we are ranked about 13th, and in terms of impressions of our scenic natural beauty, where we're 22nd. So what we've been doing for a number of years is adding proprietary questions to the Nation's Brand Index survey. And frankly, it's remarkable how stable the results have been from this first question that I'm showing here. So we asked people about whether or not the things they've seen and heard about the Games have made them more likely to visit Britain on a disagree through to agree scale. And throughout the last 6 years that we have been doing this, the Germans have been incredibly negative. They've been saying, no, we're not going to come. And what we've heard from the travel trade during the summer was the Germans weren't coming. And again, this suggests that the Germans were particularly saying, no, actually, the Games might make me less likely to come. However, from those emerging parts of the world, so the Chinas, the Brazils, the Indias, the Mexicos, the South Koreas, all of them really quite upbeat, saying the things they've seen and heard about the Games being hosted in Britain, remember this is before the Games actually took place, is making them more likely to want to visit. We've also asked a whole raft of different attribute statements. And what we can see here is that the strongest levels of agreement were with the statement about there being lots of interesting things to see and do outside of London. The weakest level of agreement was with a beautiful coastline, perhaps not at all surprising. Now, this is a bit of a cliffhanger of a presentation, frankly, because there's an awful lot of evidence set to emerge. One of the things that is set to emerge will be an additional wave of the Nation's Brand Index survey that Visit Britain and other parts of government are funding, and fieldwork will be taking place during the second half of November with results probably round about New Year's. We will be able to do a really good before and after analysis of how the world sees Britain. What we're also doing is the next wave of what we're calling our great brand tracker. So this is interviewing people in global cities where we are doing image advertising. And this will help us understand whether or not people are saying they're more likely to come in the next 1 and 3 years. We will also continue to look at the IPS data that will emerge because, as I've said already, data only through to August. By early next year, we will have detailed figures, including September, broken down by country of visitors. And we will also have figures on those visitors who weren't here primarily for the Games, didn't go to a ticketed event, but went to a free-to-view event. We also, at Visit Britain, add questions to the CAA Departing Visitor Survey, and these ask about how welcome visitors felt while they were in Britain and how likely they are to recommend us as a destination to their friends and relatives. We've been doing that for the last 4 or 5 years. We've looked at the data for the first 6 months of 2012, and it's exactly on a par with 2011, so no real shift in how welcome visitors who have been to Britain said they felt or their likelihood to recommend Britain. Late November, we will get the quarter three data of this year. That will really be the litmus test as to whether or not those visitors who were here during Games time had a different impression of the welcome that they received and whether or not they were are going to be more likely to recommend us as a destination. And we will, of course, continue to monitor all of the trends in inbound tourism, primarily through the IPS, International Passenger Survey, but also through all of those other tools that were shown in the first graphic. Not sure that was in 10 minutes, but that is the end. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David. If you have a question about the technical details about tourism to Britain, David, your man. It's very interesting now looking back at this because, you know, I was with Sandy in the Britain and London Visitor Centre at the moment that we won the bid. And outside a very few of us in the tourism industry, in which I would include Tom and Mary, everybody else thought this was a bonanza. And we knew from day one that it wasn't a bonanza. And what's panned out is exactly as what we thought. But we had a great difficulty in persuading anybody outside the world of tourism and quite a lot of people inside the world of tourism that was the case. One of the things about the Olympic Games is, of course, that 90% plus of all of the visitors are domestic. And in charge of the domestic tourism is James Beresford, Visit England. Obviously, we had the torch relay running more places around England than it's ever been in other countries because it's no longer popular to run it around in case of protests. We had the Cultural Olympiad, much money spent on cultural events before the Olympics, and then the bulk of visits to the Olympics themselves. James, tell us.
Ken, thanks very much indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, warm welcome. Delighted to see you all here today. I remember where I was when the Olympics were announced. I was driving in a car, my car, in the middle of Warrington, which is a town somewhere up in the northwest of England. So shocked was I that we'd actually won it that I went straight through the red light. A memorable occasion for me, I can promise you. But it was a different place and a different time, actually, because as Sandy said earlier on, there was a change of government, a change of the economic climate. And when I was up in the northwest, or I was at the time, my role was trying to grow the tourism economy of the Northwest through something called Regional Development Agency. And we had lots of money. And when the Olympic Games were announced, myself and other regional development agencies up and down the country were relatively convinced that we'd have that money for a wee while longer and we'd be able to do all we can to spread the wonderful effect of the Olympics outside London. But when I took this job as chief executive of Visit England, one of the first things that government did was cut all our budgets. And indeed, all the regional development agencies were closed. So all of this money that was supposed to help realise the region's potential on the back of the Olympics and of 2012 in general was not forthcoming. So it was a very different world that I entered into in realising or trying to realise the benefits of the Olympic Games from a domestic point of view. So let me just explain how we went about trying to realise that game. Now there's two things by way of context that I should say. Firstly, there can be no doubt that whether you were in the camp of this is all going to be fantastic and lots more business is going to come as a result of the Olympic Games, or in the camp of this is not going to be at all helpful, people are going to stay away, one thing's for sure, it was tourism's day in the sun. And for us folks working in tourism, working with government, it was a real opportunity to actually get tourism up the ladder of political recognition and political awareness. And actually, we struggled to do that in many, many a year. But this was a dramatic change. Government saw the opportunity that Olympics could bring to tourism and tourism to the Olympics as a legacy. So it was without doubt tourism's day in the sun. The other thing we had to do domestically was anticipate the Olympic effect. Would it be lots more people coming or lots more people going? History would tell us that actually the domestic market did very badly during the year of an Olympic host nation. And that often people would say, I don't want to be in the country when this event's on. It's going to be full. Everything's going to be busy. Everything's going to be expensive. Everything on the TV is going to be about sport. Therefore, I am going. So one of the things that we had to guard against was that Olympic escape factor that could well have happened during 2012. So what do we do in Visit England? Well, we concentrated on four areas. The first was, it was a bit of a God-given year with special events, really. We had the Diamond Jubilee, which kicked off the year. We had the Torch Relay, which was a series of events going around the whole of the nation, which often coupled with cultural performances, cultural celebrations in local communities, and of course, the Olympic and Paralympic Games. And our fourth area of concentration was around the need to protect our domestic market, and we were using the message that holidays at home are great because of this special year. So of course the Diamond Jubilee was a tremendous opportunity, all things royal, and we worked with all our partners including Visit Britain to do the most we could to help recognize this country's royal lineage and superb current royal offering, if you like. And we ran press briefings at Buckingham Palace. We had a wave of social media activity. And I'm very fortunate in my chairman being a Viscountess because we were able to go across to America and run a very, very successful media trip. And with the apologies to the Americans in the audience, and I myself am part American, so I can say this, I think they probably thought she was a direct relative of the Queen. So all of that helped. The torch relay that happened up and down the country was something that we were absolutely fixated on. We wanted to get as much coverage as we could about the places that the torch went to, the activities and the events that happened when the torch went to those places, and the fact that they highlighted some of the wonderful attractions outside London that we undoubtedly have in this country. So we got a sponsored minivan, and we had our own fan in a van. We ran a competition to find England's biggest fan, and she tweeted, she blogged, she did photo opportunities and online press views and all sorts of things just to raise the profile of all things throughout the country, focusing on England and its many varied destinations. We have the most fantastic attract brand in the world in London, but without a doubt we need to do more to shine the light of attention on the rest of England. And that's what this really helped us do. Thirdly, of course, there was the activity that we supported our partners with on games time activity. And of course, you know, I talked about tourism's day in the sun. Well, it was this country's day in the sun, wasn't it? The eyes of the world were undoubtedly trained on this country and on London. And so we did all we could to make sure we made the most of that international attention for England. And we ran a whole range of press trips and a whole range of theme press trips. We chartered the Orient Express, which was quite nice. We took the Orient Express through some wonderful parts of England's countryside, and we hosted 100 journalists, international journalists, who enjoyed the trip on the train, and each one of the carriages was given a theme of a destination in this country. Tremendous success. We also chartered the Spirit of Chartwell, which was the Queen's Jubilee boat, and we took 60 media down the Thames. Again, a great opportunity to show our very best off to a watching world. And we actually took England to London. We hosted an event, a pop-up England. We recreated England in the Tower of London by inviting a range of our destinations down to London to show off their wares to international journalists. So we did all we could to showcase what we have in England to a watching world. Now, the fourth area, of course, was this trying to protect the domestic market. Domestic tourism is worth about 80% of the value of tourism to this country, and it is important that we compete to grow that market in the future and to encourage people to stay at home, and that's exactly what we did. with government money, which was very welcome a little late in the day, but very welcome when it came. We were able to mount the biggest ever domestic TV campaign encouraging folks to stay at home. Some of you will have seen it, some of you resident to this country will have seen it. It had a wry smile on its face, it had a sense of humour, and it encouraged people really to think about what they had on their doorstep during this very special year. And all of that was backed by a number of special offers, 20.12% off offers. We had 3,000 special offers on our website. And the campaign was supported not only on TV, but through the media, through the radio, through the cinema, and so on and so forth. And it was a great success in campaign terms. You know, you can see what some of the figures say up here, but the most important thing for me, for the campaign as a whole, was that if you took motivation and involvement, i.e. liking the campaign, together, it created a campaign score of 79%. So the campaign was very effective. But actually, it delivered results. And that's the most important thing. As David said, in tracking Visit Britain's work, you can track it, but unless it makes a difference and the work makes a difference, then there's no point in doing it. And we absolutely did that. We haven't fully analysed all of the campaign as yet. But the first part of the campaign, the first 3 months of the campaign, showed that we delivered £17 million worth of business through our sites, which equates to 300,000 bed nights, with incremental spend, an additional incremental spend of 80 million. So it worked. And the campaign was a success. But what about the year as a whole, to date? To date. Now, you've heard from speakers thus far, and from myself to start with, we weren't really sure how the year would go. We weren't being cock-a-hoop, we weren't being overly confident, and I think that concern or that consideration came true. You'll see that holiday trips and visiting friends and relative trips up to the end of July were down by 7%. And that was offset, that's offset by the fact that business tourism was up by 6%. So perhaps a less than bright year, and there are very good reasons for that, one of which people remained very concerned about their personal finances, about their job security, about making ends meet, and we're very aware of that, and that was against the context. So, what else happened during this year, this very special year? Actually, the weather was bloody awful. Ask the Queen that on her Jubilee Day on the Spirit of Chartwell. The rain was incessant, and that's 4 years, 4 years of incessant rainfall. And actually, it did have an impact this year. It did have an impact. And I'm sure caused some of the drop that we saw through the earlier slide. And more worrying to me, as Chief Executive of Visit England, is the long-term effect that might have. Because 19% of those people that we interviewed said that it's likely to put them off taking more trips in England next year. But, I'm hopeful that people have got short memories. I'm really hopeful they've got short memories. Because we asked the same question about whether or not the Olympics altered their visit patterns during the year. And you can see that some said, yeah, they took more breaks, and some said, no, we took fewer breaks. Some said we spent longer in England, some said we spent less time in England. So it was kind of an even balanced scorecard. But the most interesting thing for me, and this harks back to the legacy, is that 20% of those people that we asked said that as a result of the activities and the events in 2012, they are more likely to take holidays in England in future. And really importantly for me, 29% of those questioned, 29% were young folks who said that they would be more inclined to take a break. And that shows, I think, something of the rub off of the excitement, the fizz, the buzz that the year created. So I am on my last slide, Ken. Just the most important thing for us is not just to look back, it's to look forward. We have new money from government, regional growth fund money. We're going to run a Holidays at Home, our great campaign too. We've got to keep the foot on the pedal. We will review our digital strategy. We will make sure that this great welcome that this country gave, unbeknown, unheard of before, we weren't seen as a welcoming country, is captured and used in future. And believe me, we will aim high. We've got a number of special events that we go forward. We're hearing about the power of sports tourism. 2015 is in fact the Rugby Union World Cup. And it's a great opportunity for us to keep the momentum going. We will do that. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.
Just to tell you that the context for that is that obviously the torch relay and cultural Olympiad events tended to be either free or subsidised. So if you were in business in this country in a charged access type of leisure business, you may have had a bad year because people spent their time doing the free and subsidised things and not doing the charged entry things. So attendance at attractions and so on has been down. So the capital city where the games were held, let's face it, if it hadn't been for Ken Livingstone's original foresight in being very keen on supporting the bid and also the current mayor in terms of his enthusiasm, then Gordon, you would have had a much tougher job. But even so, London and Partners, your agency responsible for looking after tourism to the capital, tell us what happened.
Okay, thank you very much, Ken. I will try and keep this very brief, and I'm going to try and break up the speakers by showing you a short film in a moment, but not yet. In terms of the city's approach to the games, and what did we seek to do, what did we seek to deliver, you've heard about displacement. We worked very closely with David and with other colleagues looking at the displacement risks. We started this work right back when London won the games in Singapore. We concluded that there was between 400 and 500 million of tourism receipts at risk in the lead up to the games. And so we worked very closely and hard with industry to try and tackle and to address that, putting in place unique reasons for visitors to come into the capital, particularly late last year and the first half of this year. And I'll say a little bit about the effects that that activity had in a moment. So in the run-up to the games, what we were saying to industry, to our partners, was very much what you've heard, that this would be at best flat, very slight uplift, but with significant displacement in normal activity. We had a Olympic working group, particularly working with the BHA, with Ufi and with our colleagues, but also with attractions and others, trying to help join up the dots, looking at the LOCOG room handback and how the various hotels tackled that, but also providing the best intelligence and information as a city that we were able to do. So what we were saying in the run-up to the games was overseas visits, there would be potentially probably very little boost, but those coming in would be different sorts of visitors, coming to watch the sport, the Olympic family, the media and the broadcasters. And there would be a very slight uplift in domestic staying visitors despite the displacement and a number of locals leaving during the game. So an atypical visitor mix, disrupting normal patterns of demand. But what we were forecasting was that we would do better as a city than previous host cities who had suffered quite significantly in the run-up to the Games. So the strength of London, the attraction of London and the connections that London had would put it in a better position than other cities. So what actually happened? You've heard a lot of this from David, so I'll be very, very brief. I won't repeat this. First half of the year, limited displacement in reality in some areas, as we heard around the Jubilee, there were some displacement on the hotel stock. But on the whole, arrivals were up slightly and spend was up slightly more. So the British figures plus add an extra percent, couple of percents for London. So probably could be best described as a steady, modest performance given the backdrop, though still a very strong performance by the industry, particularly where we saw a number of European markets fall off quite significantly. But in response to that, we saw quite significant uptake from long-haul markets. So some of the activity that we had worked with partners to put out in the market, that we had helped to curate and to promote, some of the, particularly around cultural assets, were very successful in attracting visitors in from the North American market and elsewhere. During the games itself, the games really was a sort of a business unusual period, changing from day to day. We had enormous uplifts in ridership on the tube, all-time records 3 days in a row. And so in that sense, the Transport for London was absolutely right to put out warning messages to businesses to workers here in London. But the message almost worked, probably did work too well. And what we saw in the first week of the games, particularly in central London, was
what was described by the Financial Times as a ghost town. So visitors changing their pattern of work, not staying on for the events taking place in the West End and in the city. So we pulled together, within about day three of the Games, we brought a group to the mayor, our partners, the British Hospitality Association, Society of London Theatre Attractions, Visit Britain, and others around the table with City Ops, with Transport for London. And we very rapidly turned around the messaging. So within 24 hours, the messaging changed from change your journey to London is still open for business. It's not too late to come and book. There's some fantastic things going on that you can participate in. Get back into the centre of London and reclaim and re-enjoy your city. We pushed that out through our databases, through our partner databases, hit about 5 million people in London and the South East between us, and then we wrapped that up with advertising and marketing. And most of our partners, by the end of the first week, were saying that the footfall and the traffic numbers were more or less back to where they were hoping. So I think that it was a great demonstration of the industry and the city ops, transport, working together to very rapidly turn around within 3-4 days what might have been a much bigger problem. Off the back of that, we launched with about 40 partners a late summer deals campaign, which we started during the Games, working again with Transport for London, with Oyster card providers, 2-for-1s. And again, we saw some very good take-up of that from our partners. The other thing that we did during the Games was obviously to showcase London to the world. Sandy's talked about some of the things that Visit Britain did, and we worked hand in glove with VB at the London Media Centre, which we ran. We had just over 8,700 journalists registered with us. Between them, they had an audience of between 3.5 and 4 billion people, broadcast, digital, online, journalists, print, right across the piece. And we, again, had spent a couple of years preparing for this, working with the industry to pull together a content program for those journalists. So about 200 partners, a 50-day program and 600 events, which we staged for the journalists to provide to showcase the best of London, what London had to offer, what London stood for, ranging from food, fashion, culture, business, science, technology, right across the piece. And I'll maybe just show you that very brief video, which highlights some of that.
Net apprendre leur disqualification.
9-2 winnen van de Britten.
Welcome back to the London update.
Mariachi, hubo banda, gran ambiente.
Welcome to the International Media Centre.
How you doing?
LMC, we cooperate with them, is very, very good. They are very friendly and cooperate and efficient.
It has been a good host city to us, especially the live locations. They're beautiful.
Everybody's looking at London. This was already a great city and it became even a greater city.
And of course, the real work now starts, taking those images, taking those stories. that went round the world, that resonated with different audiences. We've analysed all of that coverage. We've looked at it both digitally, online. We've developed strategic relationships with a number of broadcasters around the world. And what we're looking to do now, what we started in October, was activity to replay those messages, as Sandy said, to go back out to the markets with the stories that interested them, to give them a call to action to come and see London for itself. We've done the first, launched the first phase of that activity in about a dozen markets, and we'll be continuing to roll that out, working with Visit Britain and the travel trade to push those stories over the next couple of years, so that while we will obviously be facing a challenging global economy going forward, there is still all to play for in terms of the legacy from the Games, and we are certainly committed to delivering our part of that. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you very much, Gordon. Well, we move on now to Tom Jenkins. Tom and I, from very early days when we did the studies, we believed that the scenario that panned out would happen. It's quite interesting when Gordon says that the downturn in the centre of London was countered fast. That's enormous credit to everybody who worked very fast to counter it. But the fact is that up to that point, those who could have been capable of avoiding the messages that semi-caused it weren't listening to the story, which is that tourism has a tough time at the time of the Games. It's a very difficult time. It's a different time, and we have to manage accordingly. The person that did recognise it, said so loudly, was Tom Jenkins. Politicians didn't really like it very much, did they, Tom?
Well, this is not an unusual state for me to be in, Ken. shall I start?
Is that your microphone down on the floor? Falling off.
She wants to put it back there. I'll have to move like the wind in order for Mary to have any time at all, Ken. So, on what had hitherto been an irony-free set of admissions from DCMS, an admittedly tired Jeremy Hunt on the 14th of August had a press conference where he said that the Olympics should be for Britain what Usain Bolt is for athletics. It will help pull in 10 million more foreign tourists. And then exhorting the UK tourism industry, he said, in Shakespeare's words, on such a full sea are we now afloat, we must take the current where it serves or lose our ventures. In this, he was echoing, he was providing a coda to some of what we heard in 2006 when we won the bid, when we were told it was going to be win, win, win for tourism before, during and after the Games. This was going to manifest itself in 1 million extra visitors, 4 billion television viewers, and a legacy of increased tourism for years afterwards. Now, the origin of that 1 million extra visitors probably would take a Casaubon to analyse, but a most notable example probably lies with PricewaterhouseCoopers, who published a book, published a leaflet called How Big a Boom for London Hotels. And they gave us some estimates of what we were to expect. It's quite small, I hope you can read it. But you'll see that the high scenario, they say that we're to expect 908,440 visitors during the Games. And they then gave a mid-scenario of 660,000 visitors during the Games, which would lead to 1.8 million room nights. That's based on Athens' experience, they tell us. This was a curious thing to say, because in Athens, they only have 15,000 bedrooms in their hotels to fit in 1.8 billion extra nights. And also, Athens counts their bedrooms very carefully. And in August 2004, they had a total of 506,000 bed nights, not room nights. And by way of comparison, in August 2005, they had 394,000 bed nights. That's about a difference of 120,000 bed nights, or about 60,000 room nights. It's a bit of a striking difference between the projection of 1.8 million and the 50,000 they experienced. It's not an unusual comparison. We were told, nevertheless, by the mayor that we were still to expect 1 million extra visitors daily,
right the way through July. And the actual experience, as has been pointed out by David, was that whilst we were told to expect between 1,000,000 and 400,000 extra visitors, we actually experienced about nearly 400,000 visitors less. But if we add the 592,000 that came for the games themselves, what the tourism industry experienced was probably something closer to 1,000,000 fewer punters. What did that feel like? Well, for the hotels, it wasn't bad during the games, as we've heard. The occupancy, according to the initial release by STR, was up about 5%. The revenue up was initially up 94%, so they were making money. The shops, August footfall was about 1% up, according to the New West End Company, but they also conceded that it was 1% up against one of the worst urban riots in central London we'd seen for several years. The attractions were 40% down. The worst of the attractions were 60% down. The sightseeing companies were experiencing a 40% decline. The theatres, during the opening week, they saw a 40% decline. Second week, they saw a 30% decline. And the third week, they were still down, but they were better than the first week. This was not boom time. This was a really savage blow to the visitor economy in London, for whom August is their Christmas. The television audience, it was largely based on the Athens Olympic figures. This was 2006. They were looking back at 2004. And Jack Rogg said, the Athens Olympics broke global TV viewing records with nearly 4 billion people tuning in. He described it as staggering. It is staggering because the global population is 6.5 billion. Of whom 1.6 billion didn't have any access to electricity in 2004, and 300 million were under 5 years old. The real figures, one thing you can be quite clear on, is who is watching on the television set. This is looked at very carefully. ViewerTrack estimated that the sort of peak viewing figures for Athens was around about 127 million people. The USA had 27 million viewers. I think the London Olympics peaked at about 35 million average viewers for the opening ceremony. So the difference between the reach and the ViewerTrack research is a fairly familiar comparison. Now, when it comes to legacy, Sydney was the games, it was the first games that they explicitly targeted boosting the visitor numbers to come to a city. The normally scrupulously careful John Morse was interviewed after the opening ceremony, and he was saying, look, we still know that in excess of 3.5 billion people around the world saw the opening ceremony and saw just how creative, innovative, and the great things that we can do down here. They were very sure that it was going to lead to boom time. Unfortunately, this graph is a little bit subtle, but you'll notice that immediately after the year 2000, Australia went into 3 years of tourism decline. Now, lots of explanations given for this. There's SARS, there's the 2001 attacks, there's the bankruptcy of the Olympic carrier airline. Several factors can be cited as to why it went into decline. Unfortunately, New Zealand, during the same period, had a significant boom. Very difficult to see a beneficial impact of an Olympic legacy within this context. So if I had more time, and I know I've got to rush, I would stress that the thing to ponder on with the Olympic Games, for this is history, and I seriously wish the legacy well. We've got to see Britain booming again as a tourism destination, but if we're going to learn anything from this, I would really stress that mega events just don't fit. They're abnormal. They suspend normal business, and no business benefits from being suspended. And it collides immediately with capacity constraints. This causes all kinds of diminishing returns from an economic point of view. They're temporary, yet they demand permanent infrastructure and permanent infrastructural investment. And they place irregular demands on the service economy. How dare G4S not be able to supply 10,000 trained security guards for a two and a half week contract? This was deemed to be a national humiliation.
They're also commercially extravagant. This distorts demand patterns. It promotes investigative bias. Tell me about it. And that, in turn, leads to data management error. And lastly, and perhaps most significantly, they're conducted under the highest political stakes. One of the great problems I've got with these things is that politicians believe this is one of the things they can do for the tourism industry. Anything is sacrificed to save face. Money, transport, businesses, and reality. It wasn't without irony, I said, that Jeremy Hunt quoted from Shakespeare, for as I'm sure as Cultural Secretary, he was well aware he was quoting from Act 4 of Julius Caesar. He was giving advice to Cassius, advice which Cassius followed, and it led to the catastrophe that was Philippi, which was a disaster for the Republican cause. The end result of this was Titinius shouting at Cassius, "Alas, thou hast misconstrued everything." Titinius commits suicide, and Brutus commits suicide. There are dangers in following political advice. There are also dangers in giving it. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Now, I should explain, ladies and gentlemen, that this is about realism. Our wish is that our realistic experiences should help you. I was quite surprised that one of the things that Tom didn't mention, because it was something that worried him a lot, which Mary can pick up from a UK inbound point of view perhaps, is the fact that many of his members who had long established tours to the UK suddenly found that they couldn't do that, that their resources were removed from their abilities, they had to take it out of their itinerary. And the one thing that we all in World Travel Market and everywhere else spend our time doing is trying to build relationships which we don't want to be easily disrupted. And the fact is that they were forcibly disrupted by arrangements that were outside the control of those tour operators. But Mary, UK inbound, what do you think?
Thank you, Ken. Well, good afternoon, everyone. For those of you who are not familiar with UK Inbound, we are the trade association, as the name suggests, representing inbound tourism to the UK. We have over 280 members representing tour operators, hotels, attractions and other suppliers to the industry. Well, 2012, as we've heard, has been a very challenging year for the industry, very difficult to plan for and to predict. I will just give you a very brief overview of how the summer has been, and more importantly, what the rest of the year is looking like and into next year. This year, we reinstated our business barometer to test the temperature and levels of confidence in the industry in this very crucial year. The barometer is a survey of members to gauge levels of current and future business and to monitor what members feel are external factors inhibiting the growth of inbound tourism. The survey is conducted quarterly in conjunction with QA research through both online and telephone survey. Members respond voluntarily and in confidence and in very strong numbers. The most recent survey was carried out from the 1st to the 12th of October. The questions we asked were, looking back over the summer, how was it? What was the level of inbound bookings or visitor numbers for the period 1st of July to the 30th of September? Looking slightly further forward, what was the level of confirmed bookings for the period from the 1st of October to the end of the year? And looking into next year, what were the level of bookings or visitor forecasts for 2013? So, what was the result? Well, looking back over the summer, 37% said that bookings were considerably lower, in some cases by as much as 60% lower, as we've just heard. A further 30% said they were slightly lower, 13% said they were slightly higher, and only 7% said they were considerably higher. So looking to the end of the year, well, 54% stated that their confirmed bookings or tourist numbers were about the same, 20% said they were lower, 20% said they were higher, so not a surge as yet, although picking up from the low of August. In terms of what 2013 is looking like to date, 44% are saying bookings are higher, only 4% say they are considerably higher, 32% say bookings are about the same, and 10% say they are slightly lower. So, some optimism, it looks like, for next year. But what is interesting in the outlook for 2013 is some of the underlying comments which the research drew out. One member commented that bookings should increase year on year by 1 to 2% anyway. And this year, numbers were lower because of the hype around the Olympics and people stayed away. So, in his words, we shot ourselves in the foot and now have to rue them back. Some think people have still stayed away for the latter part of this year because of the Olympics. Others were consistently reporting over the summer the high level of inquiries for the UK, more than last year, but not that many have committed yet. And of course, despite the interest in the UK, people are reluctant to book because of the general economic global situation. We did ask members what will inhibit growth and what are the three key inhibitors to the spike in bookings that we might expect to see because of the Olympics. 64% said the global economic situation was an inhibitor. 43% said the availability and high cost of accommodation was a major problem, a lesson that we don't seem to have learned from the Olympics. And 33% said air passenger duty and VAT. So what we learn from inbound tourism and the Olympic Games is that predictably there was a significant downturn in business during the period of the Olympics. The 2012 effect was evident across the UK, not just London. When London suffered, the UK suffered. And the post-Olympic period, as we've seen, is not surging forward, but there is some sign of cautious optimism. And as yet, 2013 is not going to be a bumper year, although there are some signs of recovery. Members were asked what the government needs to do to secure the optimum momentum of London 2012. And some interesting comments here. Basically, more leadership, more action, more appreciation of the importance of inbound tourism, and more marketing. What is our call to action to secure the legacy of 2012? There is no doubt that the Olympics have given London and the UK a chance to raise its profile, and there is a long-term opportunity to capitalise on this. However, this in itself will not translate to increased business in terms of tourism to the UK. There is inaction and lack of cohesion or commitment by government to our industry in response to the challenge. If we as an industry and working with government do not begin to address the key inhibitors to growth, APD, VAT, visa problems and the cost of accommodation, then we risk losing a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mary. I think there's a very telling phrase there in Mary's commentary, which was that predictably there was a significant downturn in business in 2012. Well, just the message to anybody else around the world, Rio, etc., is that we, those of us sitting here, knew that there would be a downturn. We analysed it, we thought about it, we said there would be. But government doesn't like to hear that, and others not involved in the tourism industry don't like to hear that. And that's difficult. That means that our planning as an industry is made more difficult by people believing that we're being negative. And the issue here, I think, is to get the message across. If you're hosting major international events, they have a disruptive effect that you need to plan for. I was delighted that we were the first nation to be able to do something about deterrence and do something in order to try and counter those negative impacts. I just thought we're going to ask if there are any questions. We've luckily got a few minutes. Thank you very much for keeping to time. I'll be right with you in just a second. It's Michael, isn't it? Yes. I would just like to ask the panel, going along as we're coming to the first question, which is Michael over there, looking back on the year from the point of view of legacy, not this year, have the Olympics been good for us in the future? Or negative or neutral? Sandy?
Good. Image,
David?
Yeah.
Good.
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 I have to say neutral.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
Well, there you are. You see, so We're in the industry, we're realists, we want to make it work, we want to get the best out of it. We all think it's been good, it's been a vast expense for the nation. If only they gave one tiny little drip of that to our tourism effort, we'd be far better off. But Michael Hurst, a question.
Yeah, Michael Hurst. I'm not speaking as the chair of the Tourism Alliance. Business visits and events, this was a presentation from two industry colleagues who concentrated obviously on inbound tourism through the group markets. First of all, the event market was phenomenal. Event caterers and event organisers, event managers had a real bonanza out of the Games. We must remember that apart from the sporting activities, there were enormous amount of business activities going on, giving the brand messages of the sponsors and many others who took part in the event. The other thing is this predictability. It was predictable what happened, and whilst we spend a lot of time blaming government, and that's something I do as the chair of the Tourism Alliance, we hardly ever take the responsibility as the industry ourselves. There was a lot more we should have done as an industry to have worked through some of the issues that were predictable. I think the hoteliers in this instance failed to understand the market mix, and they might have been satisfied with a 10 points lower occupancy than the previous year's statistics at a much higher rate, but we had rooms in London that could have been sold and should have been allocated to the group business that we didn't see. I think there was a lack of marketing innovation and initiative from many of the attractions. There were thousands of people in the high streets.
That's the question, Michael. That's the question, that basically we didn't do enough.
Yeah, but all I've seen in the last three slides is that we blame everything on the government. There is a leadership
issue. Well, I didn't hear that from the panel. Weren't blaming the government for anything, really. I mean, maybe Tom had a word or two. Tom.
I think, Michael, the point you raised, particularly about the comparative boom time in the events industry, is well put. I think, really, most of the industry who chose to be informed were informed. There was an awful lot of information out there explaining what they should expect. I think the central issue really at the moment is that I'll just leave it at that. Those who needed to be informed were informed, and I'll leave it at that.
Just to say that, for example, it is illegal to make a special offer to people who are coming to the Olympics with the word Olympics in the special offer. It's part of all of the branding things that make it impossible to behave in a normal commercial way at the time of the Games. If you're interested in that aspect and what we're doing to change it, please come to Wednesday's seminar. Other comments about the question we heard from Michael on events?
Industry did enough yes. to avert some of the issues.
Yeah. Sandy will comment on that.
I think you're right. There were, and Tom as well, you know, there was a huge amount of information out there, and people, you know, colleagues from London and partners and ourselves, and we just virtually were on the road a lot doing seminars and so on, but you still had people being quoted, hoteliers and others, in London in the middle of the Games going, this is a surprise. I was expecting, you know, boom time visitors. And you just think, where have they got that idea from? So some people just maybe don't pay attention.
That's true, Sandy. But if we had tried to word a speech, if we tried to tell a meeting when on the day that we won the bid, what the world thought would happen as a result of the Olympics coming to this capital, a very well-organized capital with lots of capacity, we would have all said, it will be a good year for tourism. I think before we did the work, but as soon as we did the work, even then, you know, we knew because some of the studies had been done beforehand, was going to be tricky.
I'm not sure I entirely agree with that, because we all said this year, if we had a flat year for tourism, that would be a good year.
Yeah.
But that there was a huge opportunity off the back of the Games in the subsequent years. And I think that I still believe that we've got that opportunity. Mm. And that this year, a flat year actually is probably the best that any Olympic host city has had, if you go back to the previous
I think,
years.
Gordon, the point I was really making is that we did say that. We said that in 2 years ago and 3 years ago and 4 years ago. When we won the bid in 2005, But if you that look at understanding wasn't out there. But if you and Tom has been knocking his head against a brick wall.
But if you look at the money
understand.
That was spent, some of the figures that were up there, the 9 billion, the 6 billion on the tube network, the new hotel stock, the new attractions, the new infrastructure, that is an enormous opportunity for
Absolutely.
Us going forwards to promote that and to generate income from that.
Yeah.
But that, sorry, that's very much supply side. I think the other thing you raised, Michael, is that could we have sold the UK given that there was a minor slump? I think I can point to members who freed up capacity for themselves. They're running regional UK tours. They had to use London as a gateway. They found space in London. They didn't surcharge the departures. They kept the departures open. There was no demand. None. No demand. They had to cancel their programs irrespective of the cost of the Olympic runs.
Yeah, this is much like the ghost town of London in those early days. The fact is that the minds of people are on something else.
Yeah.
Their attention is there and you can't persuade them to do other things they don't want to do. Another question.
And when you're looking at the short term, when you're looking at the short term opportunity of filling rooms and so on at, you know, at short notice, you really have to look at the domestic market because it is
too
by that time
to
too late
help.
To get people from halfway across the world. And I mean, great efforts were made, but you've really got to look at domestic market at that point.
Thank you. As a foreign visitor, I don't worry for London on a long-term perspective. I'm sure you're going to profit substantially, particularly long haul. What I don't understand, again, and I was consulting in Beijing 4 years ago, and I was directly involved in Switzerland, in the Euro, Switzerland, Austria. Both of them had incredible bad results. In Beijing, you could get any hotel during the games. You could get any hotel. This is a fact. This is not a rumor. In Switzerland, all the figures went down. And I agree, government was also trying to talk nicely in Switzerland. The truth is, when you analyzed Bern, Basel, Zurich, and it's different size, of course, Euro, all the figures went down. So the only question that could be here in this room is, what's the mid and long-term perspective? Not the year itself. What I'm surprised is that you guys here in England, you know event management in all forms. You've done big events and you're doing it every year, that you fell into this trap. I'm not surprised we fell into this trap in Switzerland, but I'm surprised how euphoric you were. And we were shaking hands long time before that.
Well, thank you for telling me that. The answer to that is I don't think anybody here did fall into the trap. What we're trying to do is honestly tell you what happened, because we would like other people to be able to do it better. And the issue about people, the data from previous games has always been very difficult, because all the publicity is about the number of tickets that will be sold. Nobody says, but how many people will that be, and how many will be from the home nation, and how many will be go to multiple events. And it's that information that is lacking in terms of major events. Hopefully the research that has been done about the Olympic Games will illuminate that. We've only got a couple of minutes more, but let's have one more question.
Michael, thank you, Ken. I want to take issue with Michael about the idea the industry didn't do anything. My name's David Tarsh. I work in PR for a number of trade associations in the industry. I actually went to a meeting with the Minister of Tourism, not the May before the Games, but the May before that, pointing out very clearly that one of the problems we had was the pricing of hotels and the lack of availability of hotels. And let's face it, that's one thing that hasn't been very overtly mentioned, but it is definitely something that puts visitors off when they hear about high hotel prices.
Sure.
And what we said, or what I said with the person I was with, was, look, let's try and get some kind of understanding amongst the hoteliers about the levels of demand. You know how many tickets will be sold. You can analyze where those tickets have been bought. You will be able to tell the hotel industry domestically what the demand is if you analyze your ticket sales. Did the government do it? No. Did we ask? We asked everybody. I can't tell you how many people in government that we called to suggest that, to put some transparency in this marketplace. So what one has to accept is that it's quite difficult when you've got a big event like the Olympics. Lots of people who want to talk up the country, of course they get funded by government. Yep. They're in a difficult position as to what they can say, because they want to say we want to make the Olympics work. And so it's hard for people to speak out.
But there
out.
You hear the difference between the story that is promoted and the reality in the marketplace. I'd just like to shamefully again promote Wednesday seminar by saying that it's no good having empty hotel rooms, because as a hotelier, you cannot promote to somebody, would they like to come and visit you for the Olympic Games? That is illegal under Olympic branding constraints, which we hope to change, but it's going to be a big uphill task. So if you'd like to come and join us on Wednesday, because we're getting a movement going to do this, that's fine. Now, whoever's in charge of the room, can I take another question? Because we're over time. I'm willing to... There's a question over here. Can I take it? One more. Yes, thanks. Please.
My name's Daryl Adler. I'm a sports journalist. I just have a question in regard to why World Travel Market hasn't provided the international press with access to both the cable car and to the Shard.
Probably, well, I don't know about the Shard because it's not open, but there is a meeting, I think, tomorrow to give you a look into the Shard. It opens in February 13.
Take a real
the
care.
Cable car, I don't know the answer.
Take a real question.
But the Jane, yes. Jane Larkham.
Hello, I'm the PR director for World Travel Market.
Oh, right,
yes, please. I'm as disappointed as you are, because but we would have very much liked to have offered every delegate and every exhibitor a chance to go on the cable car, but they didn't want to do it, unfortunately, so I'm sorry about that, no. The Shard hasn't opened yet, but hopefully we can do something about that next year. But yeah, we did try it and we had thought about it.
So there we are, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, Jerry, I think we said one more question. Is it really quick? One word answers? Well, that's an issue of the impact an event has is about number of spectators and duration. The impact it has internationally is about the proportion who come internationally. Some of the biggest ones are obviously things like football matches, which bring whole teams in and stay for 5 minutes and go again. I think we understand that disruptive effect, but most of them can be accommodated with normal tourism businesses running. What you can't accommodate is something of the double whammy of the Olympics and the Paralympics, which have two impacts on it. So can I ask you to thank this panel? If you've got a question for them, they will be only too pleased to give you information. We're going to publish everything we can about the Olympics, because the whole point about the tourism industry is that people in it should learn to get more from it. We should give people better experiences, and we will do that by making this information available. Thank you for coming to this seminar. Do ask them more questions if you have it. Please thank Sandy Dorr and David Edwards, James Beresford, Gordon Innes, Brutus of Cassius, and Mary. Thank you all very much.